Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you this day thanking you for all that you do in our lives. We just praise you and lift your name up above all names. We ask you to guide us and direct us in everything we say and do this evening. Help us, be with us and guide us as we do the people's business. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Okay. Jerry, right here. No public comment. Gary Anders will now give us and that's not for children's presentation. Mr. Anders.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Hey. Madam Chair, Commissioners, thanks for giving me the opportunity to give you an update on the Alamance Alliance for Children and Families. I was here last year about at this time to ask your endorsement for Children's Mental Health Awareness Day, and I'm here to ask you to do that again. I'd like to actually do a three-part piece with you tonight, show you a short video that we'll tell you a little bit about who these children are that we're serving in Alamance County. Secondly, I'd like to give you a real brief PowerPoint on kind of going over an update on where we are with the Alliance right now. And then I'd like to read to you the proclamation, which I hope that you'll endorse, relative to declaring May 3rd Children's Mental Health Awareness Day. So, Kenny? Let's start with that short video.
To my school every day, where I get to run and play and see all my new friends. preschool together. Today, we learned about dinosaurs and played a counting game.
Every morning, my dad and I brush our teeth and eat breakfast together. We have our own place now, and I know we'll always be together.
This is my first day of kindergarten. I'm rested, I'm eager, I'm confident, I'm curious, I'm prepared.
I'm ready. I am your future.
You changed the first 5 years, and you changed everything.
Anyone interested in investing?
Kind of tugs at your heartstrings, but that's what we're about, and that's what we're about changing the first 5 years in children's life and giving every child the opportunity to be successful. So Kenny is pulling up that, here we go. So I think we all want the same thing for our children, and preparing Alamance County for a prosperous future begins with recognizing that our youngest citizens must get what they need today to become the adults who will strengthen our community and build our economy. So I want you to remember kind of what our goals are for the Alliance, and there's basically two. I mean, we're working on two basic levels on a community development level, on building infrastructure to make sure that this continues long after the grant is gone, and then on an individual child level. So we want to develop a sustainable infrastructure that creates awareness of early childhood behavioral health and provides an array of services and supports that allow our infants, toddlers, and preschool children every opportunity for future success. And then we want to provide direct mental health treatment for young children and their families. So what have we accomplished? And this is primarily through March of 2011. When we started, there was one early childhood therapist, clinician in Alamance County. Today we have 39 early childhood therapists and care coordinators working with very young children. When we started, we had one evidence-based mental health treatment intervention available, and now we have six. When we started, there were no mental health agencies providing evidence-based treatment for young children in our community, and now we have three. And since we began, we have trained more than 500 professional staff and childcare staff and parents and members of the communities to understand what social-emotional development is about. Because really, when we first started doing this, not many people were aware of that. And what early brain development is all about for children. And what the effects of trauma are on very young children. We've trained over 55 professional staff to screen young children for social-emotional concerns. Because first we have to identify those before we can do interventions. Over 200 children have been impacted in 22 childcare or by 22 childcare teachers in 11 different facilities who are attending or have completed classes in the Incredible Years for Teachers. We've had 61 families who have actively participated in Incredible Years parenting programs, and 18 childcare teachers have had on-site consultations from an early childhood mental health consultant. So those are the things that we're doing kind of on a systems level. And over and above that, we're doing lots and lots of training in early childhood mental health evidence-based practices in order to treat these children. And then on an individual level, you know, we have 79% of the 127 children, which is 127 children of 160 who have been referred, have had comprehensive in-home mental health assessments. Presently, 94 of those children have been enrolled in the Alliance and have received or are presently receiving mental health treatment. 82% or 70 of those families have a family partner who is actually working with them. This is a parent who has a child who has had mental health concerns and is now helping that family in their work to navigate the system. So those are the primary things that we're doing in Alamance County. I told you a year ago that we were going to start getting national data, and that's one of the things that we are mandated to do with this grant. Is we have this huge national database that we're collecting information on. And this is about 50 slides, and I've cut it to 3 because I think that I want to give you the highlights. So this is a bit hard to read, but this is presenting problems, and you have this in your handout. So presenting problems for those children that we've been seeing. And you'll notice that the primary area there is disruptive behaviors in young children. So we're seeing primarily boys. That's where it's been. But there are other behaviors that are also looked at here. Persistent noncompliance. Excessive crying and tantrums that maybe a lot of us have dealt with our own children. Separation problems, which is, you know, anxiety about being separated from your parent. And this is a real interesting thing, I think, is, you know, 33% of these children have sleeping problems or sleeping disorders. A good percentage of them, over 21%, child maltreatment. If you go to the next slide, I think that this is really very, very telling. So if you think about the conditions, the environments that our children live in, 74% of the caregivers report some history of mental illness. 52% of those caregivers report some history of substance abuse in the family. If you go down into the matrix there, over 42% of these children have witnessed domestic violence. In these households, over 34% of these households have someone living in the household who's committed a major crime. That's a felony or above. And this is two really important things here, I think, are almost 30% of these children have experienced physical violence, and 9% have experienced some form of sexual abuse. These are major stressors in children's life. And this is my last slide that I like to share with you, commissioners. And this is another major stressor. It's called poverty. If you notice in the right-hand box there, you take the first 3 and add them up, over 50% of the families of the children we're working with have incomes of less than $15,000 a year. And over 20% of those families have incomes of less than $5,000 a year. These risk factors add up to disabilities. There's a current study that came out just recently called an ACE study. And it equates stressful conditions, like I've just pointed out, especially these here, with disabilities. And children who have 4 of these conditions in their lives are 4 to 12 times more likely of having a disability than children that do not. The good news here, and there is good news, is that children are resilient. And that with the proper interventions, children will thrive. But we have to provide those interventions. And if we do that, that will lead to reduced costs. And we know that these will be reduced costs in child welfare costs, in foster care, in mental health costs, in substance abuse costs, in special education costs, in juvenile justice costs, and clearly in corrections costs. And these children will become productive taxpaying citizens to our culture and to our community. Any questions on what we're doing?
The this is from the SAMHSA grant too.
This is all the SAMHSA grant. Exactly.
Gary, on these studies that they did in child care, are those like in the private child care facilities through the county or?
They're private, public. We have these interesting statistics about preschool. In preschool, the expulsion rate from preschool is 3 times what it is in regular school system. It's 13 times in child care centers what it is in regular school system. It's amazing. And that's behavioral concerns that we can do things about, and we know we can do things about. And those children arrive at school not ready to learn.
Well, you've got to fix the home situation prior to them getting to school, I think, to help them in that situation.
So early childhood interventions, Commissioner Boswell, is about working with families.
Yeah.
It's all about working with families. You're exactly right.
Gary, what's your primary referral source? Is it the counselors at the schools, or is it?
Our primary referral source right now is threefold. It's child welfare. I mean, it's one of our major target populations. We're embedded in child welfare. It is the school system, specifically their pre-K program, which now they have a pre-K social worker who is making lots and lots of referrals. And it's the CDSA, the Children's Developmental Service Agency, which is responsible for 0-3. We will be opening doors up, and we're opening doors up slowly because we're going to start talking with every pediatrician in the community, and that will be a major source of referrals for us for both not just interventions but prevention activities as well, because we know if we can provide prevention for children and families, we don't have to let it get to the intervention level. So that's a major push for us in the next year.
The line item that you've got here with this grant expenses years 1-3 for Alamance Partnership for Children doesn't seem like a big item. First year, $117,800, $140,000 for the third year. It doesn't seem like a lot of money for what we're showing you. But how much money had to be spent, as far as you know? Was Duke University study preeminent with what you were able to establish here, or was that separate? Or
So our grant has numerous contracts.
Mm-hmm, I know.
With a number of providers. We do have two contracts with Duke University, one for evaluation and one for training. The one for evaluation is, again, according to SAMHSA, it's a mandatory that we have to provide 2 full-time FTEs to do evaluation, and they are responsible for both national and local evaluation. The national evaluation consists of doing in-home work with the families that we're working with. They administer 15 instruments every time they go into the home. That's done on 6 months intervals, and it's done for a period of 2.5 years.
Could you have set up this? I mean, again, the line item is not much at all, as far as I'm concerned. Could you have set up something within our own realm of county offices or activities or agencies without spending what we spend at Duke? I mean, unless, if I'm not mistaken, have I added this up wrong? It appears to me we have paid Duke $983,000, right at $1 million for studies or whatever they do. Is that correct?
For the last 3 years,
right? Combined.
2.5 years. That probably is correct. And I would agree, Commissioner. I think it's very high.
Thank you.
I think it's a lot of money, but those are the people who know how to do this work, and there's not a huge cadre of folks who know how to do especially the evaluation work or training on these evidence-based practices. So we have this contract with the Duke Center for Child and Family Health, and that's part of the National Center on Child Traumatic Stress. So, I mean, we're working basically with the experts. Most other SAMHSA sites also contract with universities to do evaluation. You know, I would love to actually do that with Elon. I don't know what their capabilities are. But it's good, great point. We'd like to keep that money in Alamance County.
I like to keep it in our federal government as far as knocking off the deficit or the debt. Again, we're spending $1 million to put out some small line items here, it appears. What are other counties doing that don't have this, who don't have this grant with the same type of children who have the same needs?
Yeah, they're doing nothing. And this is an interesting thing because we are now in a comparison study with Union County. They don't have a system of care, they don't have a SAMHSA grant, and we are looking at a similar child welfare population and comparing that population to the child welfare population that's getting some services within SAMHSA. And I, like you, I'm very interested to see what the result of that will be. But Union County wanted to do that because they said, we want what you got. and we would love to make that happen here. So what these other counties are doing, and I think what we're doing across the country, because we're one of six early childhood sites in the country, is they're waiting for results from us because they'd like to emulate, I think, what we're doing in Alamance County. We're here on the cutting edge doing work that other places in the state and in the country want to know how successful and what we're doing to get good results.
My last question is it possible to get some type of analysis or program presentation, as you've done here tonight, to show us what Duke did for $1 million? Because I feel like, forgive me, but I feel like we need to have checks and balances even all the way down to this level of what we obtain from the federal government to be responsible for and accountable for. And it's hard for me to understand how they have earned $1 million in less than 3 years.
We could certainly get you some data on that. And I'm sure that we could have, I'm not sure, I would ask the people from the Duke Center for Child and Family Health to present information to you on what they're doing, and the Duke Center for Child and Family Policy, who's doing evaluation, to provide data on that as well. So if that's a request.
It is, for me.
Yeah, that would be nice.
Well, they also go to the meetings, like when we were in Tampa.
Right. Well, they're
they were there.
Exactly.
With us there. So these are things that you must follow the grant. We don't want
to take it away. Michelle could be inquisitive as to how money is being spent.
That's fine. Yeah. But I'm just saying, you have to follow the rules of the grant, or they will take it away from us. And, we'll lose it. And that's something that I feel like we don't want to do, because we've made a lot of progress from this. Because I've seen it myself, and I've heard people. When we were in Tampa, they were praising us in Tampa because of what we had done in Alamance County. And the people that were there, they couldn't believe that the people from Phoenix had two people there. But how many people were there? I forgot, 900? Was it 900?
I think that was 700.
From all countries, and they were from everywhere.
Now, is Duke doing any of the studies with any other counties in the state?
Durham has just gotten a SAMHSA grant for older children, for transition age youth, so those who are kind of, 16, 17, 18-year-olds. And, yes, Duke is actually
so
doing
actually
evaluation for
them
as well. Yeah, they have a long history of working on these kinds of initiatives. So, you go to where the expertise is.
And I guess the data is really what you need to show that this type of intervention is what's working.
Exactly. And then, again, there's a national evaluation that's set. I mean, we have to provide that, which is extensive. And then we're actually doing a number of things locally to look at what we're doing here specifically.
Okay.
So...
proclamation.
Well, I'll work on that, Commissioner. And then I'd like to move on to the proclamation. I hope you have that in front of you. Alamance County Proclamation, Children's Mental Health Awareness Day 2011. Whereas experiences in the first 3 years shape the architecture of a baby's brain and build a foundation for lifelong learning, good health, and success in the workforce. And whereas too many infants, toddlers, and preschool-aged children are born into and grow up in environments that narrow the opportunities for realizing their potential, which comes at a great cost to all of us. Our county's prosperity is jeopardized when the future of so many children is compromised. And whereas infants, toddlers, and preschoolers with social-emotional problems who receive early intervention are more likely to complete high school, live independently, maintain productive employment, and avoid pregnancy and criminal behavior as they mature. And whereas it is important that children, along with their families and communities, learn the warning signs of mental health disorders and where to obtain necessary assistance and treatment. And whereas the participation of family members in the assessment and treatment of children is integral to positive clinical outcomes. And whereas an awareness of mental health services provided in Alamance County can lead to diagnosis and treatments of these mental health disorders. And whereas National Children's Mental Health Awareness Day provides an important opportunity for our community to show how children and youth with mental health needs, as well as their families, thrive when they have the right supports and services available, and that positive mental health is essential to a child's healthy development from birth. Now, therefore, and I hope I can read this, Commissioners, the Alamance County, Alamance Board of County Commissioners does hereby proclaim May 3rd, 2011, Children's Mental Health Awareness Day throughout Alamance County, and urge our citizens and all agencies and organizations interested in advancing every child's success to unite on that day to promote every child's mental health and resiliency in every environment that has an impact on child development. And I'd like to provide you with Children's Mental Health Day of Ribbons. And I hope that you wear in honor of that day.
Thank you, Gary.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. I appreciate the time.
Okay, do I?
I'll make a motion that we proclaim May 3rd as Children's Mental Health Awareness Day.
Second.
Second, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Do you want me to sign this one, or do you have one you want us to sign?
Well, I'd like you to, that would be.
Just sign this one.
Mm-hmm. And you could pass it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. She needs a pen.
And I'll pass it.
And I'll pick it up after the meeting.
That'd be fine.
Great. Thank you very much, Commissioners.
Thank you.
Thank you
for okay, your
presentation.
The next agenda is Sweet Proclamation
by the Lee. Can you hear us? Color.
Oh, okay.
Landfill
Solid Waste
Specialist.
Thank you.
Good evening.
How are you? Good evening. All across North Carolina, April 16th through the 30th, counties will be observing and participating in Campaign Litter Sweep, sponsored by the North Carolina Department of Transportation through their Adopt a Highway program. Litter Sweep promotes and increases the awareness of roadside cleanup while encouraging recycling. Inasmuch as Litter Sweep depends on a strong public-private partnership, we have invited Mr. Charles Vitu, Vice President of the Elon Exchange Club, to be here this evening. He's a member, has been a member of the club for 8 years, serving several of those as an officer. The Elon Exchange Club has been actively involved with the Adopt a Highway program and litter sweep campaigns for over 18 years. We thank them for their continued effort and commitment to keep Alamance County beautiful. In an effort to help promote this litter sweep campaign, I would like to recommend for the Commissioner's consideration the following proclamation, which I believe you all have a copy of. Whereas the North Carolina Department of Transportation annually organizes a statewide spring roadside cleanup to ensure clean and beautiful roads in North Carolina. And whereas the spring 2011 litter sweep roadside cleanup has been planned for April 16th through April 30th, 2011, and encourages local governments and communities, civic and professional groups, businesses, churches, schools, families, and individual citizens to participate by sponsoring and organizing local roadside cleanups. And whereas the great natural beauty of Alamance County and all of North Carolina, along with a clean environment, are sources of great pride attracting tourists and aiding in recruiting new industries. And whereas the cleanup will increase awareness of the need for cleaner roadsides, emphasize the importance of not littering, and encouraging recycling. And whereas the spring litter sweep will celebrate the 23rd anniversary of the North Carolina Adopt a Highway program and thousands of volunteers that donate their time and labor year-round to keep our roadsides clean. And whereas the litter sweep cleanup will be a part of educating children regarding the importance of a clean environment to the quality of life in Alamance County. Now, therefore, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners hereby proclaims April 16th through the 30th, 2011, as litter sweep in Alamance County and encourages all citizens to take an active role in making the county cleaner and more beautiful.
Any questions?
How are you promoting this in the schools, or are you promoting for the children?
It is promoted actually through the Adopt a Highway program. And so the schools that have groups that are listed as contracts for that get promotional packages with all the everything they need to do the litter sweep.
So the schools are working with you on it.
Mm-hmm.
Good. We appreciate what you're doing.
Yes, we do.
Thank you.
Do I hear a motion that we accept this?
So program? Moved.
Second.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you.
You have one of them. Is this one?
That one is. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Next is a request to set a public hearing. Judge Martin.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. You should have in your packets a memorandum from me requesting to set a public hearing for a subdivision waiver. We've received an application requesting a subdivision waiver from Section 67 of the Alamance County Subdivision Ordinance, and this is in order, the applicant is requesting the waiver in order to build a garage on their property, and they're requesting specifically a waiver from the setback requirements to allow for that. Staff recommends setting the public hearing for May 2nd, 2011 at 7 p.m. And I'll be glad to take any questions you have.
I'm assuming you'll send notification to the surrounding people.
Yes, sir. We will send notification to the adjoining property owners and also run an advertisement in the newspaper.
I'll make a motion then that we set a public hearing.
Second.
I'll make a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
The Alamance County GIS Department has worked along in conjunction with the Planning Department on some revisions to the Alamance County Road Naming and Addressing Ordinance. If approved, the proposed revision would rescind and replace the existing ordinance. As required by general statute, a public hearing must be held prior to any amendment or adoption of an ordinance. Staff is recommending setting the public hearing for the ordinance on May 2nd, 2011 at 7 p.m. With that, I'll be glad to take any questions.
I'll make the motion we accept that date.
Okay. Second.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you.
County manager report.
Team manager.
I do have a presentation I'd like to do first, and then I got a couple other things at the end. Where is the? Oh, there it is. Thank you.
Gary messing with you.
Appreciate that. One of the things that has kind of come up as part of this budget discussion is what is mandated by general statutes for counties to do and what is not mandated. And I was a request from Commissioner Sutton to begin looking at this. And I was actually at a county manager's budget forum in Raleigh. And this subject came up. And the county manager from Pasquotank actually put a list together. Went through the statutes, and I think he got it from some of the book from the school of government, but it actually lists what's mandated services and what's not mandated. And I thought it would be a wonderful opportunity for you as a board to look at to see what we're required to do and what we're not required to do. One of the things I had to do in this is to make some assumptions. Didn't want to look at revenue generated by the department or activity into consideration. It's too confusing. Basically, what we looked at, if the department, such as EMS, which is a mandated service, if that is required, we listed the full budget request. You know, not looking at levels of service with any of these, but looking at this completely as an expenditure. Again, not questioning level of services. Again, if we looked at levels of services, there's a lot of things that we could look at. If we look at statutes, for example, counties are required to provide funding only under statute for the sheriff and two deputies. Naturally, we have a higher level of service than that. However, that's the minimum that we have to have is that. Again, if we look at planning is required, but the enforcement of a high-impact land use is not required. That's above and beyond what's required. Fire inspections, emergency management, mandated, but we do a lot of assistance to our volunteer fire departments, not mandated. Again, counties are required to maintain a solid waste reduction program. However, county landfills are not mandated. So again, those are just a couple of examples of where we do mandated services, but at a much higher level. Again, I'm going to go through these fairly quickly. These are county mandated services. Excuse me. Again, EMS. This service must be available to all residents. It can be privatized, but we choose it as a county service. 7 million, Board of Elections, County Attorney, Emergency Management, Cooperative Extension, 911, finances required under statute. Governing bodies required. A clerk to the board is required. Health departments required, medical examiner, sheriff administration, and we're also required to have a jail. Information technology is required, permits, inspections, planning, register of deeds, social services, soil and water. It's not mandated, but once we form one, we are mandated to provide services under statute. Solid waste, again, it's a separate enterprise fund, tax. Personnel, if we have personnel, we are mandated under statute to provide and make sure we meet the requirements of state and federal employment law. Again, I'm not going to go through all of these. I believe you've also seen a 17-page document that I gave you that really lists in detail mandated services that each department are supposed to provide. But there's the sheriff's, social services, again, additional mandated services, work first, all these, you know, again, with the corresponding GS numbers. And again, I'm going to go through these fairly quick. Again, these are some non-mandated services that we do above and beyond. From general assistance, our Family Justice Center is above and beyond. The SAMHSA grant is above and beyond. Comprehensive Assessment Grant is above and beyond. And the Office of Violence Against Women grant is above and beyond. Again, Health Department mandated services. These are the five that must be provided. And again, I'm going to just flip through these. And also looking at this, we kind of have some mandated funding requirements that we're responsible for. ABSS, $35 million. We're required under statute to provide funding for mental health, $1.34 million. We have a commitment for retiree health insurance that we have to provide, and that's $1.212 million. Alamance Community College at over $3 million. Our court system, animal shelter, which we have entered into an agreement with Burlington and the other municipalities. Debt service is required funding and required funding that we have to pay for. We are committed to pay off that debt service, and our debt service annually is $11.14 million a year. Tourism, Tourism is a pass-through, but it is something we have agreed and we have passed by a local bill. Again, that's the occupancy tax that we get from our hotels. So again, that's a pass-through, but we're mandated to pay that. My only question is, and I apologize for not knowing this, we have an agreement with the airport authority. And I'm not sure exactly what the agreement says, but our funding level to the airport authority is 282. So, again, I don't know if that was done by an agreement years ago that the board saying we're going to jointly fund this. So, but this is something we've funded forever in 2 days. Again, these are non-mandated services. Again, administration, county management. I'm not mandated. So that's $400,000. That's not my whole salary is $400,000, but that is county management as a whole. Parks and Recreation is not a mandated service. That's $2.2 million. Library is not a mandated service. That's something we provide. Building services, maintenance, and grounds at $1.423 million. It's not mandated, but something we have to have. Outside agencies, and I'm going to show you on the next slide, make up $2.44 million of our budget. Judicial services, again, $539,000. We don't have to do school resource officer. Veterans Affairs, printing, purchasing, GIS, central permitting, garage, Division of Forestry, and passport services. Again, those are non-mandated services that we do provide here in Alamance County.
Have you got a grand total of the dollars of those non-mandated?
I tried to, but again, to look at revenue, taking it because some of them are revenue generated, and if you took out, I apologize.
Well, I understand. Yeah.
Won't give you a truth.
Outside agencies. These are areas and agencies that we fund above and beyond. Economic development. We fund our contract with the Chamber, the Piedmont Triad Partnership, and again, Burlington, Alamance Airport Authority. That's my question mark, knowing if it's mandated or not. Human Services, Family Abuse Service, the Weatherization, the Dispute Settlement Center, Home and Community, Congregate Nutrition, Meals on Wheels, In-Home Aid, Adult Daycare, Alamance Elder Care, ACTA, Culture and Recreation, Historic Museum, the Sword of Peace, the Arts Association of Alamance County, the North Carolina Symphony, and Public Safety, Alamance County Rescue Squad.
I have got to point this out about North Carolina Symphony. If you don't think things are tough, it was in the paper, one of the papers I read the other day. Huh?
Well, they
no, this was a Philadelphia orchestra, yeah. If I'm not mistaken. 111-year history. Best of the United States filed Chapter 11 bankruptcy. Mm-hmm. Philadelphia Orchestra Symphony or...
Yeah.
That's amazing.
I didn't see that.
Not enough stimulus money.
But those are outside agencies that we fund above and beyond. And again, what do we do with this information? This was a wonderful educational opportunity for me, again, and I hope it is for the board and public, to look to see what we are required to do statutorily, that we have to do as a county, as a arm of state government, and what we do truly have options with and what we truly don't have option with, you know, especially looking at mandated funding requirements with debt service. You know, we had to pay our debt service. Again, in looking at our budget, if cuts are required, it's important to see what functions, expenses, or fixed costs, and what are not. So, again, special thanks to Randy Keaton from Pasquotank County for sharing this information with us, and I appreciated him doing that. But, again, when we go through the budget process and as we move forward, this may be some information that we use and we try to finalize our final budget. And kind of where we're at on that, and Amy, correct me if I'm wrong, we're working on version 2 that we should have to the Board of Commissioners at our May meeting, at our first meeting May 2nd.
questions?
Well, you can also comment, in my opinion, that you can have a mandated service, and you can you can subsidize it, but you don't necessarily have to throw as much money and or employees at it.
Exactly. Well, and that's what I'm saying. The level of service, you know, we did not go through and look at the level of service, you know, because it varies. And again, there's revenue that's associated with that also. So that would have made it really, really difficult. If we really started boiling down to brass tacks, you know, that's when we could, you know, focus more on individual departments, if so requested by the board.
But those dollar amounts you had in red, that's just what we actually are funding. That's the funding level
budgeted
currently.
Current yes, funding levels.
Right. And for the departmental expense, that's budgeted request without cuts to this point. So, any additional questions?
No.
All right. And I do have a couple other things that I'll sit down for. One of the items that you do have in front of you is an ordinance to designate the historic courthouse as a location for public notices on the courthouse door. During renovation, we had to designate the youth services building as the quote-unquote county courthouse. State statute requires a 60-day notice to designate a new location, and we would like to request that you pass an ordinance, which is in front of you, to designate the Alamance County Historic Courthouse as a new location on or about June 20th.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
And I do have one other thing, if I could.
Craig, what's the date of your celebration, your grand reopening plan?
June 11th.
June
11th. Yes, sir.
And that's
10 a.m. to about 12:30.
Okay. Thank you.
So, also in front of you is a request. We are currently part of a regional workforce development area partnership with Orange and Randolph. We have been requested by Moore County and Montgomery County to join our consortium, and there needs to be a resolution that is passed to approve of that new workforce development region.
What's the function of
that? Basically to look at workforce development, you know, look at working with unemployment, working with community colleges, trying to get people back to work. But there's no cost to the county.
And two, to designate me to be back on that board. I'm back on the board.
Yes.
That's something new for me.
Yes, sir.
What you need is another job, right?
I do. I need one more.
Bored.
I'm trying to find the
proclamation. It's on the back.
Here, no.
The resolution is on the second page.
Resolution.
Yeah, it's in the consent agenda. It's L. Yours is
Yeah, I've already
L.
signed that one. I met her for lunch.
Oh, okay.
And I've already signed that one.
Well, here's the resolution.
Yeah, the resolution on the second page.
We need to approve it.
Right.
Resolution.
All right. Do I hear a motion?
I'll make a motion that we approve the resolution designating regional partnership workforce investment area.
Okay.
There you go.
Motion?
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
And that is all I have.
I think that's what you're looking for. You just have to sign.
No, you don't sign the consortium, but I thought that was another one. Is there not another one?
There may be a couple of. Yeah, there's.
There's
a memorandum of agreement that's also in here. I think the motion could cover everything.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah.
So, yes, ma'am.
Okay. We'll move right along to the consent agenda. Is there anything that we need to pull from the consent agenda? If not,
I was going to see if anybody else wanted to pull it out. 10D.
How'd you guess?
Okay.
Got it out. It's a travel request. It's social services, please. You know, I know you think I'm picking on you.
No, sir.
I love children as much as anybody.
No. Don't doubt that at all.
And I can assure you I would do all I could to... You know what? We talk about how we feel about wanting to help people, and adults, elderly, young people.
Yes, sir.
And I can, this is sort of aside from, but it's related, I think. If our country goes any further down the tubes financially, fiscally, morally, ethically, leadership-wise, family-wise, if you think you got a headache now, if these children are going to be, and adults and elderly are going to be less stressed, I mean, the best thing we can do for everybody in every category is to take this country back up the ladder rather than create lower rungs at the bottom.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And I think that's what's happening to it.
I think we would agree 100% with improving.
Saturday, I was sitting in my car, it was starting to rain, I was getting ready to go to the library, and I opened up my packet, and I saw the travel request for Chicago for this summer, and I guess that's another $14,000 or better.
Yes, sir.
And I swear I'm not trying to make light of this, but you just got back from Tampa.
Yes, sir.
With all due respect, the bags haven't even been unpacked very long. I think the total so far, how long have we had this grant?
We're in September. We'll finish up year three.
September of this year, so we're
yes,
just barely.
It's upon a federal fiscal year. We're almost through with year three.
Okay, but it's barely 2.5 years, right? Roughly.
We have 6 months left.
Yeah, that's 2.5.
Yes, sir.
As of July or whenever that, if I'm not mistaken, it's going to be $68,000 in travel.
When you add the.
The Chicago trip.
That's correct.
$68,000. What is expected to happen in Chicago that didn't happen in Anaheim and didn't happen in Tampa?
That's a great question. I think that's a great question. In the memo that I sent you, highlighted a section from the grant RFA and the cooperative agreement that we signed, and it says that. Applicants are required to budget for travel and attendance of a core team of approximately 10 individuals for at least 2 meetings per year to create and sustain a learning community among all grantees. Every year in July, that was Anaheim, last year Washington, this year Chicago.
D.C.?
Yes, sir. Okay. There is a once-a-year grantee meeting that is required for all the sites that have a grant. That is where we come together. Best practices are shared. We get they ask for a finance officer to go. We get he gets training on the finance piece. I'm the principal investigator. I get training on that piece. So that's a once a year thing for the grantees to all attend. And then we have a choice of several other system of care opportunities across the nation to complete our required 2. We chose, as a team in Alamance County, to attend the Tampa one in March. They seem kind of close together, but
Tampa had a focus on early childhood intervention. Our keynote speaker was Jeffrey Canada from the Harlan Children's Zone. And so our grant, as Gary mentioned, is one of six in the nation that focuses on early intervention. So that's why we chose the Tampa one. I know they're kind of close together. But we are required to attend two per year.
Two a year.
Yes, sir.
So it appears that you're saying that we can count on two trips to the tune of $14,000 a year, roughly $30,000 a year in travel.
That's right.
Just for those big conferences, let alone anything small that you might go to, right?
Yes, sir. But the rest of what we go to is usually in North Carolina.
In reading the memo, it said that up to 15 people could go.
Yes, sir.
But there would be a waiting list. Who pays, if it's approved that they can go above and beyond 10, who pays for the other five?
Federal grant. The federal grant says a minimum of 10, a maximum of 15.
Yeah.
And if you have more from your community that you want to attend, you go on a waiting list for additional spots.
I guess I've never really asked this question as point blank as I want to ask this one, but ask it this time. But why do you think they limit it or mandate 10, the number 10?
I don't know the answer to that.
What do you think? What's your best?
I think that they're trying to accomplish, and I think we have been successful with it. We certainly, I think we were in Tampa, and as we've learned, with our other community teams, that's where we do a lot of planning offsite. And what they want you to accomplish, and what they say in the grant is to sustain a learning community among your community leaders. And if you read the grant, it spells out a child welfare stakeholder, key stakeholders from other child serving agency. So they want to create. Just because SAMHSA is a grant, and when the 6 years is over, the grant will be gone. And so if we haven't done our community work to develop our community infrastructure for these programs, then it'll be for naught. And we certainly have built this from the beginning to be here beyond the grant and to continue to have a positive impact on the lives of those children from once the grant is over. This, I think you had a great question about Duke University's contract. While one of them is for evaluation, the other is for training. And what we have done with that is invest in Duke to come into our community and train our professionals here so that they're rostered and licensed in interventions, evidence-based interventions, outcome interventions, which we'll see soon, I hope. It takes a little while, and we're only in the second. Our first year was a planning grant year. But to train those providers so that when the grant is gone, they'll be here in Alamance County, and they'll be trained, and they'll be serving our families. And they'll be billing insurances and Medicaids and working with our school systems and our CDSA. So I think the goal of 10 to 15 is to build that learning community, to take our leaders and make sure that we're building something sustainable beyond the grant. And that actually, and Ms. Massey and Mr. Honeycutt can say, that's where we've gotten the most attention at these grant meetings, because that is our focus, is to, I think she mentioned that there was a grant that's ending in another community, and that there were two people there because their grant's over and their programs are going away. And we've been focusing to make that not happen here.
Phoenix, Arizona.
Oh, I can't remember where it was. I think that's the reason for 10. I don't have any other, I don't have any other information.
You don't think possibly they sit back and say, well, we know how many grants we've got out there. If we get 10 there, make 10 come, we'll have a 500 people meeting, or you just don't think it's...
I do think that we do, that there is an opportunity for strong community work, and I think that's what, that may be the reason, and I don't doubt you that might be, but I think we use it in a different way in our community.
Well, how many people in North Carolina applied for the grant that we got, Tanya?
I don't think there were any other North Carolina applicants when we applied. Now, since then, Durham has applied and received a grant. There were 19 applications and six awarded the year that we were awarded.
Nationally?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it was my understanding when I called Washington that very few people applied for the grant.
It's a very rigorous process, and it was an over a 200-page application. I mean, 200-page that we submitted.
And on this one letter here, it's very specific as to who should attend that.
That's so, right.
I mean, you start adding up who they've designated have to attend. Two or three people can't go and fill all those positions they're trying to fill there.
That's correct. And they do have a track for each of those. There's a track for principal investigators. There's for project directors.
Which gives it more of a diversity in the community when you
that's
come
correct.
Back.
That's correct.
Because I
remember. Well, my goal with any of this inquiry is... It's not personal. I promise you it's not.
Whether you believe it or not.
It's just my goal that every tax dollar has got to be spent to its maximum efficiency. And I do mean maximum. Forgive me, with all due respect, I don't see it here. I don't see it. The line item for what he showed us tonight is minute compared to the totality of the grant. I think the trips to spend $68,000 in travel in 2.5 years, or to commit to it with the last Chicago trip, in 2.5 years is exorbitant. And that's why the federal government, in my opinion, with that mindset, that's why we're getting ready to really hit the bottom if we don't turn it around. And somebody's got to pay the price for it. And I'm afraid that the people that are going to pay the price for a lot of the frivolous and excessive government bureaucracy is going to be the children. It's going to be the adults who are going to become senior citizens. And then we'll have hell to pay to try to turn that around. So that's my line of inquiry and why I do it. And I'm sorry I have to keep doing it. But.
Well, and I, from our standpoint, I think most of the folks who were, As Commissioner Boswell mentioned, are required to attend. I think that staff, they lose personal time. Our per diem is $30, which works in Burlington, but it doesn't work in Chicago, $30 a day. They lose, personally. I don't think it's something that all of our staff really want to do. We feel like that it's part of our cooperative agreement. We are required to do that, and we try to maximize as much as we can having to be there and getting the information out and bring it home and put it to use. And so I appreciate your concern.
Well, let me ask you a hypothetical question. If the federal government stopped it due to the budget and or we just said we don't participate in it anymore, can you comment in both arenas as to what would happen going forward? In other words, we know Duke, you've paid them $1 million in 2.5 years to come in here. How much more are we going to pay Duke, by the way?
Well, our contract with Duke is going down each year because the big chunk of, the evaluation contract will stay pretty steady. The grant had very rigorous requirements of what education level the evaluators have to be, and so that will stay pretty steady. I think that was, they're split apart on that summary. Our training contract with them is going down. We've been using a concept called the Learning Collaborative that Duke has been sponsoring. It is a national breakthrough series training mechanism. It trains folks in the new evidence-based practice. It's a year-long training to get rostered in one evidence-based practice, and Duke provides that year-long. So they meet together 3 or 4 times. They provide all levels. So when you're training on an evidence-based practice and you're trying to embed that into an agency, you got to have all the levels of participation. The upper level has to support, management has to support therapists in a new way. So the Learning Collaborative trains at all those levels. They train with the online practitioner, the middle manager, and the managers. Then there's a series of a year-long process of doing case reviews. So they get on a conference call and they go through and get it's called supervision. They get supervision on the clinical part of that practice. And so that's what Duke has been doing for us. And as Gary showed you on the slide, we've gone from, you know, zero or a few practitioners to 39. So that's where the big chunk of our money is with Duke, is that intensive training. And so that, we have trauma-focused CBT.
Right. And we are going to be participating in a collaborative that will cost us nothing, called Attachment and Biobehavioral Catch-Up, because we're collaborating with another grant in Guilford County, and they're paying for that one because we invited some of their clinicians to participate in our trauma-focused cognitive behavioral therapy.
We've completed wraparound, wraparound learning collaborative.
And we've had a few people participate in parent-child interaction therapy. And this summer we'll be doing a small learning community on child-parent psychotherapy. So, you know, our goal is to build capacity so that we can treat all these children. And again, as Susan said, we want to make sure the infrastructure is there. So we're working with the with the Children's Developmental Service Agency for young children. We're working with school ABSS system. School system, their EC department for children 3 to 5. And those are our portals that will be there after our grant is gone, to work with these children and families.
And the therapist will be embedded in our community.
That's it. I mean, once they get that training, they're trained. It's not like that they're going to take that away with the grant money.
Right. That's right.
And this learning collaborative is not only education, it's implementation strategies. So that we have long-term implementation, so that when therapists leave organizations, they have a way to train a new therapist in doing that application. So it is it's a long-term piece, and most of our money is built on developing local infrastructure to make sure that this continues.
Correct.
Question 7. 10C, I'd like to, well, I got a couple questions I'd like to ask
about.
Do we
need to vote on this, or do you want to put it back for the vote?
No, we voted on Tampa. I'd like to vote on this, too.
I make a motion that we forward this.
I have a motion that we accept this application for travel request.
Second.
I have a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
No.
Okay. All right. You move forward.
Well, Tennessee.
Retirement incentive program.
If we accept this, are you going to go back and hire those same people?
No.
We would not.
Can we put a motion in that
and
certify that we aren't?
Yeah.
It's kind of be kind of crazy to let people retire and then bring them back and pay them.
We would not do that because what we're trying to do is save money.
I've got a couple of letters, and there's a couple of people that's employed by the county that are saying that we're doing that, and they are really disturbed about it.
We got rid of Sam.
You
said we got rid of Sam.
I'm not talking about Sam.
What we can do is add a section in here about not eligible for rehire.
Not be rehired. That's good.
I read it, but I didn't see that.
Do we give any financial advice as to how they should handle their affairs after they leave with that dump-in money and so forth and so on?
We really don't, because we're talking about the money that they're getting is $100 a year. So if for a 30-year employee, we're talking about $3,000. So we don't feel like we really are qualified to give advice anyway. But they do, when they sit down for their retirement session with someone in my office, they go through the paperwork, and they've got the option of calling somebody. We give them the contact numbers for the state or the local government retirement system. They can also call and talk to the 401k representative too, if they want to do something with that money to put it back into the system. Yeah,
there was an article in one of the papers I read last week about some people really making some major mistakes taking early retirement with their finances, and
right,
they're not
mm-hmm.
knowing until it's too late. They've screwed up.
Right. And the incentive that we're talking about, it's really the people who are going to be interested in it are people who have already been thinking about retiring but just haven't jumped over that ledge yet. So
maybe we need Clyde to word that. How does that need to be worded, Clyde?
Will those same people get their longevity pay?
No.
No, they would not.
And that's kind of the beauty of this, is many people kind of wait around the January 1 to get it. So this, we get about
so that's why we're given the timeline. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'm going to put that back. I just needed to ask those questions.
And we can make that change also.
Something like employees who choose to participate in the early retirement incentive policy will not be eligible for rehire by Alamance County.
Right.
Okay.
Sounds good. All right. I make a motion then we accept everything on consent agenda.
Second.
And second, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right.
Did you go to the rest of the consent agenda? Yes, everything, the rest of the consent agenda.
Is the attorney
and
board
meeting? Clive,
is
yes.
Our attorney
and
board?
Yes, yes, I gave you one.
Not appears.
Do you not have
that? I have one in the board. I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11A3 in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney and the board of commissioners. I need a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Motion. And second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Ms. Master, yes, this for an existing lawsuit?
We don't know.
I don't know. We haven't got any idea.
Mr. Albright.
I don't have any idea.
Do you mind if I ask you? Mr. Albright, you read the wrong statute.
Oh, okay. Well.